Now, for the sake of time, we have to go to the last presentation. I have the pleasure to invite my dear friend, Professor Hadi Skouri. Professor Hadi is Associate Professor of Clinical Medicine, Director of Heart Failure Program at American University of Beirut Medical Center, and he's a board member of the Lebanese Society of Cardiology. And he's going to talk a very complex topic, comorbidities in heart failure. Professor Hadi.
Good evening, even though in some places it's midnight now. I would like to thank the Egyptian Cardiac Society for the invitation, in specific Dr. Magdi Abdelhamid for his initiative involving several Arab countries. And actually, I would like to extend my thanks to Dr. Shukri and congratulate him for his new position as the president of the society. Also, I am honored to be part of this distinguished faculty, but nothing can be successful without the continuous support of Professor Sivrovic. So I will be the last speaker here and talking about comorbidities in heart failure. Though there are many, we'll try to summarize them and at least talk about the most important ones. So already we know that when we see patients in clinic, encounter patients in clinic, a lot of time we have several comorbidities, like example, COPD, diabetic, and kidney disease in the same patient with heart failure. And the questions come, can we uptitrate the medications? What to do with the ACE, ARB, or ARNI with this creatinine if it's 1.5 or more, or there is a reduction in GFR. The patient is COPD, can we increase carvedilol on these patients? These questions come to most of the physicians and cardiologists. Also, if the patient is on optimal medical therapy and still symptomatic, fatigue, weakness, dyspnea, what are we going to do more? Do we have to go directly to the device therapy, or we have to check iron deficiency, do polysomnography for sleep apnea? What's next in these patients? So the impact of emerging comorbidities in heart failure really has impacted the heart failure complexity. It's becoming more challenging and impacted the progression of heart failure as the clinical outcome, whether it's a hormonal or metabolic abnormality, an organ involvement abnormality, cardiovascular mortality, or a social or psychological comorbidity. In most heart failure registries and trials, some patients have more than five comorbidities, patients with heart failure, I mean, and the most common ones are depression, COPD, diabetes, which was already alluded by Dr. Sivrovic, sleep disordered breathing, and other cardiovascular morbidities. But at the same time, many of these comorbidities are actively managed by specialists in the other fields of the comorbidity, like psychiatrists, like endocrinologists, etc. And these comorbidities may impact not only the mortality and morbidity of the patients with heart failure, but they have also related to quality of life reduction. And the presence of these comorbidities will really complex the medical management of these patients, in addition to increasing healthcare costs. So what is important in these comorbidities, it may interfere with the diagnostic process of heart failure like COPD and beta blockers and dyspnea, aggravate heart failure symptoms and further impair quality of life, contribute to the burden of hospitalization and mortality, especially COPD, and renal failure, and it may affect use of treatment for heart failure, like treating with RAS inhibitions in a case of chronic kidney disease or beta blocker in a case of asthma. Evidence base for heart failure treatment is more limited because trials have excluded these comorbidities in most of them. Drugs that may be used for some of these comorbidities, like arthritis or anti-cancer for chemotherapy, they may worsen heart failure. And there always there will be an interaction between the heart failure treatments and the treatment of comorbidities, resulting in lower efficacy and poorer safety. And maybe this can be reflected by the qualified trial which was published in 2016, and several other follow-up trials in 2017 and 19, showing that a lot of patients, they have poor adherence to medical therapy, especially when it comes to targeted therapy. Only 23% of the patients are on targeted therapy, and this is reflected on the cardiovascular outcome. The more the patient on a targeted therapy and the more the adherence, the better the survival and the lower the cardiovascular death and hospitalization. Also, symptoms of heart failure, the patients with heart failure, in their majority, they remain symptomatic even they are on optimal medical therapy. And this is where the European Society of Cardiology HFA guidelines in 2016 has comprehensively alluded a complete section about the comorbidities, including 17 comorbidities in heart failure patients. So the management of comorbidities is a key component of the holistic care, really, of patients with heart failure. So we have to treat the patient as a whole, not only treating heart failure. And one important thing is not only to improve survival and reduce morbidity, but also we need to improve the quality of life of these patients. So I'm not going to talk about all these comorbidities, but we'll summarize some of these. We know that hypertension is the second most common cause of heart failure or the cardiomyopathy. And when it occurs in patients with heart failure and reduced ejection fraction, ESC has alluded a real recommendation, step recommendations for these patients. So we know that HFrEF patients, they may benefit from ACE, beta blocker, and MRA, and these are at the same time antihypertensive medication and should be the first line of treatment. Then if the patient is still hypertensive, we go to thiazide diuretics as the second choice for these patients. And the third step will go to amlodipine or hydralazine. A second option, a class 2 indication, is flunitrazone, but we have to make sure that there are class 3 or contraindicated treatments because of increased mortality or of negative inotropy, like diltiazem, verapamil, alpha adrenergic antagonist, and moxonidine. The second one is stable angina pectoris. We know that ischemic heart disease is the most common cause of heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. And also, this slide or this diagram from the ESC 2016 guidelines showing the stepwise recommendations for treating angina. We know that beta blockers is an anti-anginal and it's class 1 indication for HFrEF, so we have to use it the first step. If the patient is intolerant to beta blocker or already he is on maximum dose of beta blocker and the heart rate is still above 70 and has anti-angina, we have to add ivabradine as a class 2 indication. If the patient is still tachycardic, having pain, angina, we can add a short acting or a long acting nitrates, then trimetazidine, amlodipine, nicorandil, or ronalazine as a class 2B indication later on. When it comes to myocardial revascularization, if the patient is on optimal anti-anginal therapy and is still symptomatic, then we have to go to the interventional part with revascularization. And always, I should remind of class 3 indication or not recommendations of combining ivabradine, ranolazine, and nicorandil because of unsafety reasons, as well as giving diltiazem or verapamil for HFrEF patients because of negative inotropy. Going to other non-cardiovascular comorbidities, one of the hot topics is anemia and iron deficiency without anemia even. We know from registries that and clinical trials that anemia is prevalent, around 30 to 40% of patients in the registries and up to 20% in clinical trials, they have anemia. Not only that, but anemia, whether in HFrEF or HFpEF, has proven to increase in the CHARM program trial to increase death and increase hospital admissions. And there came the treatment of anemia with darbepoetin alpha versus placebo. And in this trial, even though it was neutral for the primary endpoints and secondary endpoints, but has adverse events like thromboembolic events that made this medication as a class 3 or harmful medications. But we know at the same time that iron deficiency is the most common cause of anemia here in green, and the iron deficiency is even the most common cause of anemia at all ages. And in heart failure patients, around 40 to 50% of the patients have iron deficiency, and in acute decompensated, this can go up to 60 to 70% of patients. Not only that, but around 40% of the patients, even though they are not anemic, but they have iron deficiency, and this is important. And there are a lot of mechanisms why we have iron deficiency in heart failure, in addition to hemodilution and edema, reducing gut absorption of iron. We have the intake of PPIs that will decrease iron absorption, intake of antiplatelets that they will increase bleeding tendencies. In addition, inflammation will cause increase in hepcidin that will decrease iron reabsorption too. So we have two types of iron deficiency: reduced iron stores due to GI blood loss, malabsorption or malnutrition, or reduced iron mobilization. It's a functional iron deficiency due to inflammation as described above. And the definition of iron deficiency in heart failure is a ferritin less than 100 or 100 to 300 with a TSAT or transcellular saturation of less than 20%. TSAT is iron over total iron binding capacity. So even when iron stores started to be depleted, we can have symptoms even though without reaching anemia stage. And not only that, iron deficiency will reduce exercise capacity even in non-anemic patients. And iron deficiency is prevalent in HFrEF, half mid-range EF, and HFpEF. Even in HFpEF is more prevalent. And the higher the NEHA class, the higher the iron deficiency prevalence. And iron deficiency in all these classes of heart failure will reduce cardiopulmonary exercise and VO2 max. And here came the FAIR-HF trial. It was the first double-blind placebo trial in patients with NEHA class 2 to 3 and EF less than 40%, and they have iron deficiency as stated the definition. And they studied the primary endpoint of NEHA class improvement and the secondary 6-minute walk and quality of life, and really it improved regardless of the presence of anemia, the functional class of these patients as a primary endpoint as well as the secondary endpoint regarding NEHA class, 6-minute walk test, and patient global assessment. And this was based, this was the basis for the second trial, which is the confirmed HF trial, which used the same population. And the primary endpoint was 6-minute walk test, and the secondary endpoint was change in NEHA class and worsening of heart failure. So the primary endpoint was with the patient with the iron injections. They have better improvement in 6-minute walk test, significant compared to placebo at 24 weeks. In addition to secondary endpoints of global assessment score, NEHA class, etc., as the quality of care also improved. But what is more important as secondary endpoint is the first hospitalization to worsening heart failure, which was significantly better in patients who were receiving IV iron. And in several meta-analyses, IV iron has been alluded to reduce all-cause death and cardiovascular hospitalization, reduce heart failure hospitalization, improve 6-minute walk test, NEHA class, LVF, and NEHA class, as well as the quality of life of these patients. And this is why in 2016, ESC guidelines, it was stated as a class 2 indication to give intravenous ferric carboxymaltose in patients who have iron deficiency. And was stated also in the 2017 ACC guidelines. There are ongoing trials in acute heart failure and heart failure with preserved EF to see the efficacy of IV iron. Second one is the chronic kidney disease. Also, Dr. Firas has alluded about cardiorenal syndrome, but kidney dysfunction is very prevalent in patients with heart failure. Up to 30 to 40% of patients, they have a GFR less than 60, and around 40% they may have microalbuminuria. That is, the kidney and the heart failure have a bidirectional relationship. and why it's important to talk about the chronic kidney disease, because it is the responsible for, at the end, for the fluid retention and salt retention, and this is where the RAS inhibition works. And the patients who have renal dysfunction, it's they have this. I mean, renal dysfunction is one of the strongest predictor of clinical outcome. We can say it's a risk marker too. So why it's important? Because when we start treatment of these patients with RAS inhibition, especially, there are two misunderstandings, because we under-prescribe this medication. We are afraid of increasing creatinine and reducing GFR. And sometimes we withhold potentially life-prolonging therapy because of this misunderstanding that they are maybe nephrotoxic drugs. There are also several definitions for the renal function in heart failure, and this makes physicians more hesitant. But the definition by the ESC is a GFR less than 60 or a albuminuria greater than 30 milligram of albumin per 1 gram of urine creatinine. And the worsening renal function is an increase in creatinine of 0.3 or more than 25% with a drop in GFR of 20%. Recently, early in 2020, there was a position paper about the evaluation of kidney function throughout the heart failure by the HFA. And here we can say that the trajectory of heart failure patients, the trajectory of glomerular filtration rate is higher compared to normal patients. When the patient has heart failure, and when we start RAS inhibition, this may become higher. And already by Dr. Magdi Abdelhamid has shown that secondary reversal may improve the reduction in GFR in these patients. And though there is a reduction in GFR when we start RAS, but this reduction is translated into a better risk of heart failure admissions and mortality. So we have benefit, though the reduction is there. And when we interpret kidney function in accordance, we should interpret it in accordance to circumstances, whether in the acute or chronic setting, whether during uptitration of medication, whether during the patient is stable in a follow-up setting, and to differentiate between a state of congestion versus volemia and hypovolemia. This is another position statement by the AHFA showing that organ dysfunction is important when the patient is congested, because congestion can cause organ dysfunction not only on the kidneys, but on the liver, intestine, etc. And the most important thing is venous congestion. Venous congestion is more important than lower cardiac output in the cardiorenal syndrome. There are different scenarios when it comes to heart failure and chronic kidney disease management, whether on the initiation of treatment of RAS, whether worsening during uptitration, or whether worsening during follow-up. In the acute setting, whether there is an AKI on admission with acute heart failure or worsening renal failure during congestion, decongestion, or before discharge. This is a recommendation to say that when we are during uptitration of RAS inhibition, if the increase of serum creatinine is less than 30%, we should continue unless we have symptomatic hypertension. Between 30 and 50%, we may consider stopping uptitration, and above 50, we have to temporarily stop and reinitiate later on. But when we have doubling of creatinine or a GFR less than 20, we have to stop RAS inhibition in these patients. Always, we have to go in parallel and avoid any medication that can cause nephrotoxicity, like antibiotics, non-steroidals, and contrast iodine. We have to avoid hypotension, dehydration, and hypovolemia, because the kidneys are very sensitive in the low cardiac output state to develop acute kidney injury. Always we have to give the lowest possible dose of diuretics and to uptitrate neurohormonal blockers whenever it's possible. When it comes to renal dysfunction in men, especially males, always in elderly males, we have to rule out prostatic obstruction in these patients. A third comorbidity is sleep disordered breathing, sleep apnea, whether obstructive central, which is most common in heart failure, or it's mixed, but also sleep disorder can be a result of anxiety, depression, but one of the most common causes, it could be congestion, pulmonary congestion, and they or diuretic therapy because of the nocturnal diuresis. And this is where important history is important. History taking is important to differentiate and treat the patients accordingly. We know about obstructive sleep apnea due to closed airways, and it can occur in HFrEF, but the most common cause is central sleep apnea, where there is open airways, but we don't have any chest movements. This is what we can see in obstructive sleep apnea. There will be no airflow, but there is chest movements, and there will be desaturation, while in central sleep apnea, no airflow, at the same time, no chest movement with the oxygenation. Sleep apnea can impact cardiovascular system significantly. It increases sympathetic activation, increased atrial arrhythmia, increased inflammation, oxidative stress, and intermittent hypoxia that will may lead to hypertension, systemic congestion, and reduction in stroke volume. There are a lot of modalities to treat nocturnal hypoxemia and obstructive sleep apnea and heart failure, oxygen, CPAP, BiPAP, or adaptive seroventilation in central sleep apnea, but none has been prospectively shown to be beneficial on major outcomes in heart failure. This is the CPAP. Also, the adaptive seroventilation for central sleep apnea has been used to supplement ventilation during apneic or hypopneic phases of breathing cycle. But here came the SERVE-HF trial, where it showed a neutral effect on the primary endpoint and increase in death or cardiovascular causes. And this has made the use of adaptive seroventilation, and this has been stated in the ESC-HFA guidelines as a class 3 contraindication. There are ongoing trials on phrenic nerve stimulation, which has been proven to be promising in these patients, and it has been stated in the 2019 update by the HFA that the use can be considered as an alternative, but we need a study to investigate the impact on mortality and mortality with the phrenic nerve stimulation in the coming in this heart failure population. Cancer is important, and it can be prevalent in heart failure patients. We know that cancer survival is increasing. Patients with cancer can live up to 15 years. Cancer can occur in elderly patients, and we may have patients with cancer that they need to be treated and they already have heart failure, or vice versa. After treatment, they develop heart failure. We know that a lot of chemotherapeutic agents, they may develop cardiovascular complications. One of them, and the most common, is heart failure and or cardiomyopathy, and it can be a type 1 or type 2. Type 2 is due to trastuzumab therapy or targeted therapy, while type 1 is mainly due to doxorubicin because of cell death. And this, here comes the role of cardio-oncology in heart failure patients, because we need early risk stratification, early diagnosis, prevention, and treatment, because we don't want the acute cancer patient of today to be the heart failure patient of tomorrow. And the two main goals of the cardio-oncology is to avoid the possibility that cancer therapy may lead to heart failure, or to avoid the possibility that pre-existent heart failure or cardiac disease will lead to the reduction in therapeutic opportunity for the patient to be treated. A consensus paper or a position statement in 2016 by the HFA was published, where it stated that we need a baseline risk stratification for these patients is important. There are a lot of trials on cardioprotection during anti-cancer therapy, where ACE inhibitor, ARB, MRA, statin, iron chelators, and beta blockers, or a combination of ACE or beta blocker, have been proved to be beneficial in reducing or preventing cardiotoxicity. So it's always important to know what is the cardiotoxic drug and how to treat or prevent this. Two publications published recently, one in January 2020 by the ESMO guidelines about the cardiovascular management during oncological treatment. And recently, this was published online last week about the baseline cardiovascular risk assessment in cancer patients scheduled to receive cardiotoxic cancer therapy. It's by the European Society of Cardiology Heart Failure Association Cardio-Oncology Study Group and the International Cardio-Oncology Society. It's important, this document is important to read. Other comorbidities like Lyme disease, asthma, and COPD, always it's safe to start beta blockers in patients with COPD. Only with asthma we have to make sure. Steroids, oral steroid therapy in patients with lung disease may cause sodium and fluid retention, and we need to be cautious about this. Erectile dysfunction is prevalent in heart failure and may reduce quality of life. And PDE-F5 inhibitors are important and they are safe in these patients. When it comes to gout and arthritis secondary to hyperuricemia from diuretics, hyperuricemia is treated with worse prognosis in heart failure, and gout attacks should be treated with colchicine and intra-articular steroids, not oral steroids and not non-steroidals, because non-steroidals are class 3 indications, and especially in addition to COX-2 inhibitors have been stated as class 3 indication because of their complications and water and fluid retention. Depression is also very prevalent. Treatment of depression till now didn't prove to be in heart failure to improve the quality of life, but always it's underdiagnosed and should be treated at least with cognitive behavioral therapy and with treatment, even though we need several more trials to improve to prove that depression is important. Treatment of depression will help in heart failure improving of quality of life of these patients. Always elderly, they have to be, and the frail patient, they have to be monitored more and more, especially with the polypharmacy and with the geriatric help in these patients. Comorbidities, there are a lot of gaps in the evidence, whether because of elderly patients, young patients, chronic kidney disease patients, diabetic patients, we are having more and more data in chemotherapy, in cachexia and depression, all, especially in HFpEF and HFmrEF. We need to more study these comorbidities, and there is a lot of evidence gaps. And then I would like to thank you, and I want to just emphasize that treat the patient as a whole, not just the whole in the patient. So we need to treat all the comorbidities, not treating only concentrate on heart failure therapy, but also we have to concentrate on the patient himself or herself. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Hadi, for this comprehensive talk, very challenging, complex, but well done, because a lot of topics. I have a question regarding cardio-oncology, which is a very impressive subspecialty in heart failure nowadays, regarding the use of biomarkers and the global longitudinal strain to identify early the subclinical LV dysfunction and to initiate early the cardioprotective drugs. So what's your comment regarding this?
Thank you for this important question, because always we are asked about biomarkers as well as and echocardiography, even especially global longitudinal strain in these patients. As I already stated that primary prevention in cardio-oncology is more important than secondary prevention, because we don't want to look just at LV ejection fraction, because when the ejection fraction drops, then already the cardiotoxicity had occurred. So we have to look before that. And this is why there are multiple studies on GLS, and it has been shown that a drop in GLS of more than 15% drop on follow-up of this patient during cancer treatment has increased the risk of LV dysfunction during cancer therapy or at the end of cancer therapy. And this is why starting these patients with ACE inhibitors and beta blockers from several preventive trials have shown that it reduces significantly reaching LV dysfunction in this patient as an endpoint. And concerning biomarkers, most studies are troponin and anti-proBNP. For troponin, it can be used, and it has been used in some algorithms with doxorubicin, because whenever we have an elevation in troponin in these patients, then this signify an increased risk of LV dysfunction, whether in the near future or in the long-term future. And there are several studies by Daniel Cardinal, from 10 years ago until now, from 2016 now, showing that starting ACE inhibitors on these patients who had to develop positive troponin or persistent positive troponin, they improved, even though positive troponin with a normal EF, it reduced the progression into LV dysfunction. There are some studies on anti-proBNP, but they are still, it's not well used as a troponin as a biomarker, but it can be used like in targeted therapy as in trastuzumab, because we have LV dysfunction more than cell death in the follow-up of these patients. And I am part of a position statement by the HFA about biomarkers in cardio-oncology that already is submitted, and hopefully it will be published, accepted, and will be published soon, stating that in different chemotherapeutic agents, how to follow up these patients and which biomarker to use. Also, there is another position statement that will be coming from the cardio-oncology group about the non-invasive imaging or imaging modalities in cardio-oncology that hopefully will be published this year too.
Great. I have a question here for Dr. Layla regarding the use of lung ultrasound in diagnosis of heart failure.
For lung ultrasound, it's indicated only for especially acute heart failure. For acute heart failure, to help us for the diagnosis. So we'll see, I forgot the name in English.
Lung comets.
Yeah. We see lung comets. More we have lung comets, more it's in favor of the diagnosis of acute heart failure. It's class 2A in European guidelines for the diagnosis of acute heart failure. But in practice, it's very helpful to guide us to establish the diagnosis.
Especially in emergency rooms where there is no availability of anti-proBNP, it will be maybe more helpful.
Yeah.
So I think the time now we are too late.
has to sleep.
Yeah, 3 hours, especially Dr. Faraz. It's too late for him.
I can tell you it's 1 a.m. here.
Yeah, I know. So at the end of this successful first Pan-Arab Heart Failure Summit, I'd like to thank all of you, Professor Peter Sivrovich, the President of Heart Failure Association. Thank you very much. We are honored with your participation and accepting our invitation today. It's your contribution made the event a great success, really. So thank you very much.
Thank you, but we all did it together, you know, and I would like to thank you on behalf of HFA that you gave us the helping hand to be together and to work in this, which is probably the starting of good cooperation in the future. Thank you once again.
Thank you.
I'd like to thank Professor Faraz Badr, Professor Hadi Skouri, Professor Laila Abid, and I think today we established the Pan-Arab. This is part of the Pan-Arab Heart Failure Society, Heart Failure Working Group, Summit, all names, and we will repeat. So I'd like also to thank Novartis Company for sponsoring this event. I'd like to thank Dr. Ashraf Badawi, CEO of IRIS, the organizing company, and Adam, who managed the technical support today. to again thank you very much for your contribution, your participation, a very wonderful virtual event, and I hope we can repeat it every now and then because it's very successful and the interaction with the audience was great. A lot of discussion, a lot of interesting questions, and I think we covered all topics related to heart failure, starting from diagnosis up to the new drugs for heart failure patients, comorbidities, acute decompensated heart failure. Everything was discussed elegantly and excellent. So thank you very much for your contribution
thank
to this.
Thank you, Magdi, and thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you, Professor.
Thank you. Hopefully see you soon.
See you soon. Stay safe and take care.
Stay home, stay safe. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye-bye.